We're all like that.
Basically just a search for YouTube for...
It was nine pounds. I know the guy, I know the guy. It was 9 pounds.
See up at the top, it says pages. There's a...
Was he like...
Then if you do the top one, DNewTech on YouTube.
So we can access this at a later date or whatever?
Yeah.
Yes. Wait, I'll just record myself.
You clicked on that, did it actually?
Yeah.
Should be.
Oh, yeah. Facebook Live myself.
Just click on the picture. Click on the link.
How do I get that?
So we can access this a little bit. I would just delete that way to echo, but it's under under pages. In under pages, there's a link for you right there. I just follow instructions there. It's all pre-recorded, so it'll be safe too. Thanks to our friend Roger.
Yeah, bring that back up again. I want to get a shot of it.
What?
I want to get a shot of it on the screen.
What?
Of the video? Live feed. Yeah. We're going live here. We just had it live, I don't know what happened.
I know, I did too.
Yeah. No, I just saw the perfectionist.
Go live. Where are you going to be, right there?
I'll be right here. Okay, so meeting adjourned. I want to say welcome to our first DNewTech of 2017. And I want to say thank you to everyone for being here in this cold weather. The temperature dropped tremendously, so I'm really glad that you guys can all make it, especially the presenters here. We have a really good group of people.
First of all, I want to say thank you to Grand Circus. I want to turn it over to Tricia, who's kind of been kind enough to let us use their space, not only in 2016, but we'll continue using their place in 2017. A couple other sponsors I'll mention later, but I'm going to turn this over to Tricia for
a while. Hi, everybody. Welcome. I see quite a few familiar faces. Is this anybody's first time to our space, though? All right. Very cool. Glad to have you here. We're on the fourth floor right now. The third floor is our main space here at Grand Circus. Our main focus is coding boot camps for people who want to change their careers and become developers. So our boot camps are 10 weeks long. 8 weeks is in-person training, Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, and we help place our students in their new careers. And our placement rate is 90% within 90 days of graduating, which is really exciting. On top of that, we have evening workshops. We host events like this, and then we also have co-working space on our second floor. So if you're interested in learning about coding boot camps, workshops, more events we host, or if you'd like to join as a co-working member, definitely check out our website, just grandcircus.co. And I think that's all I have. So thanks for coming out tonight. Have fun. Again, if you have any questions, our website is written on those back whiteboards as well as the Wi-Fi information.
I'm just curious, how many of you guys, I know you guys have been here before, how many of you have actually been through the program? I know there's some instructors here. So yeah, I mean, pretty much, I mean, it's a pretty good time not to, I think at Accelerate Kid, which is a company that I run with kids, we actually have two of their staff who actually graduated from the program. So it's a really good program to go through.
Yes, thank you. Have fun, you guys.
Thanks, Tricia. So I also want to say thank you to a couple other sponsors here, and I'm going to try to get through here. But pretty much we get really good help from Invest Detroit. They pretty much are an investment company that's based in Detroit that funds a lot of the economic development in the city. We have Tech 248, which is out of Oakland County. It's a initiative from Al Brooks Patterson. And then we have Oakland University, which also places that we go twice a year, in April and in September. It's out on the campus of Oakland University. They allow us to use their space, but also they do a lot of work with the startup community. And they're also known as a Smart Zone, which is a MEDC, pretty much an MEDC Smart Zone, one of the few that we have in the state of Michigan. And then we have my company here in the Grand Circus. So just want to say thank you to everyone. With that, I'm going to go ahead and turn this over to the team. But pretty much we have Roger here doing our video. He's been doing this from, I think, started 6 years ago when we started this at Wayne State University. We typically are a spin-off of Ann Arbor NewTech. If you guys have been to Ann Arbor, they've pretty much been around close to a decade now. And they have such a great following. We started this about 2010, so it's going on to our seventh year, I think. And what's been going on is that we've been doing a little bit different. Our format, where we usually have a guest host or guest speaker, and today we have Aubrey, and he's with Blackstone LaunchPad out of Wayne State University. He's going to come up here and talk a little bit about his program and hopefully give you some suggestions and ideas from his experience in the startup community, but also with some of the startup companies that he dealt with. Typically, we do bring people like that as well as investors and funders, so that way you can actually get some advice, but also hear from some of those who are actually funding companies. And then we have about 45 startup companies that do pitch their ideas. The whole idea here is just to get you familiar with presentation and hopefully get some of the crew out here to kind of listen to your ideas and give you some feedback. Because it's a good idea, but you know, if you don't pass the DNewTech test, then it doesn't mean anything. So anyways, with that, we're gonna start off with the first company. You got 5 minutes, and usually, I know some of you guys are gonna take a little longer, but we try to keep to 5 minutes, and then we have 5 minutes Q&A. Then right after that, we'll, you know, we switch to the next group. First, before we start with Stu, we're gonna bring up Aubrey. And again, I'll let him talk a little about himself, but I appreciate for coming up, man.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, let's give him a hand.
Thank you.
So I've known Tom for, 10 years?
Yeah.
11 years? We had the same mentor, John Cox.
Yep.
That's right. So Han has been at the forefront of entrepreneurship here in Detroit and pushing for others to go about it themselves for over 10 years. So it's awesome to see all these things happening in the city of Detroit. But I remember it was like him and maybe five other people, and it just was a smaller group back then. It's so good to see you still at it. So we're happy to be here. Really quick, my name is Aubrey Agee. I have one question for you. How many of you like to fail?
Oh, raise a hand. I've failed lots of times, and it's good experience as long as I pick myself up at the end.
That's it. That's a speech. I'm done. Right, so no, but failure is a huge part of success, and that is what entrepreneurs run into all the time. Have you guys? Everyone's been here, like, successful every time, batted 100. Has that been the case? No? Somebody? You? No, I'm joking. So failure is where we learn most of our teachings, the things that make us better, make us stronger. Has anybody ever competed in a pitch competition? Okay, all right. And did you win? Okay. So, a lot of times I see folks do pitch competitions, right? And the winners, they seem stellar, they seem amazing. Sometimes you think, second place person should have won. And sometimes people that don't even place, you think, oh, they should have won, right? And a lot of times we see those people that didn't win, right? We see them 6 months later, hustling, still going, grabbing customers. And so a lot of times, it's awesome to win, and that's nice validation. But those who lost step back and they look at what they could have done differently. They try to poke holes, more holes in their own business to fill them, right, to make them better. And that to me is what I have seen over and over again in entrepreneurship. So my name is Aubrey Agee. I work for Wayne State University. I run the Innovation Warriors program. So we brand ourselves differently this time. Just like you change your company name every 3 years. So we help people explore entrepreneurship at Wayne State University, not just the students, staff, or faculty, but also the surrounding community. So my apologies. So we have a program called Blackstone LaunchPad. We actually coach individuals on starting their companies. So we're consultants that kind of hold their hands a bit, but we're giving them tools, we're giving them advice. And then when they reach a certain level, then we start introducing them to resources, individuals that could help them out. So it's a give and take relationship. It's not something that it's not a class, it's not a requirement that they have to do certain things. It's always up to them. And so if life happens with a student that's married, that has three kids, and a sick parent, and a business, it's fine. You put pause, keep, you know, handle what you have to. But we always have this open door policy for them to come back. So, but when somebody says we're really serious and we want to, you know, I want to start a tech business, you know, we start pushing them. You know, if they want to be pushed, we push them. Okay. We use certain tools such as like the business model Canvas. We introduce individuals to different programs all over the city, such as Focus Town, such as programs at Tech Town. We really are about trying to put through the help. Bring the community together. So one of the big things that we do, I don't know if any of you have heard this. Has anybody heard of Hack WSU?
Say again?
Hack WSU.
I went to the competition.
That's right.
2 years ago.
And remember, you have a development team, don't you?
No, I was gonna make Uber for ice cream with my team, because it sounded cool.
Yeah.
And we just kind of were messing around, but.
Yeah.
I was there I'm not a developer.
Okay.
But I was there as more like a
I think I remember you.
Had a good time.
Yeah, I remember that. And you had a team with you, right?
I got a team of dudes together. I still talk to one.
Good.
He's a pretty good developer now.
Very good. So to fill you all in, it's a hackathon that myself and Jason Beal, who's in the back here, who's actually one of the best pitchmen I know in Michigan. So Jason, you're tall, you don't stand up, just move your hand, hit the ceiling. Jason works with me at Innovation Warriors, and is actually, he was a driving force in putting on our Hack WSU program, which is a 24-hour hackathon that we have once a year. And we usually have it the weekend before the holiday in May. But we also, what we did after our second Hack WSU, is we host Hacker Nights, Detroit Hacker Nights. And so we've had people anywhere from like 15 to 50 show up every Thursday evening since last May to work on their projects. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to encourage the tech community to go ahead and use Wayne State. Come on through. We usually have people that are there that are experienced. This last semester, we had a gentleman from GE Digital, and he ran some of the workshops. He helped out some of the teams that wanted to build IoT apps, as well as there was another one they wanted to do a virtual reality training session. This semester coming up, we have Detroit Labs running our workshop, and they're running workshops for the entire semester up until a couple weeks prior to the hackathon. So what we are trying to do is we're trying to encourage folks to be technologists, to not be afraid of technology, to use each other, to use Wayne State, and if you have a project, we'd love to help throw resources at that. So you guys are all welcome. It's a free program. We are going to start, I believe, the last Monday in January. And so we've switched to Mondays. It seems like it's a good day for our students. And it's a day that if you're really motivated, you'll come out. If you're not, you won't come out. So, and we'll have Detroit Labs running. They'll be actually working on several projects. So I don't know, has anyone ever gone to Detroit Labs, like open house or the apprenticeship programs, that kind of stuff, right? So did you do some of those?
I just went to the open house and like had a meeting with, it was like an event.
Did they have like some of the exercises that
no, we're just in their big open space.
Okay, so they actually, I bet we got some students. We've had many hackathons at Detroit Labs, and it's been awesome because they have a couple like challenges for the participants to do. So they're going to do certain challenges that'll be fun, that you'll be able to develop certain apps. They'll have certain categories, and they'll work with you. They'll have at least like three employees there at a time. So we also are going to bring in GE Digital technicians and coders when needed. So like we have an IoT team that was working on a project last semester. Their project was to create sensors that are ran by Arduinos to predict elements of the weather, you know, like wind speed, temperature, pressure, and they wanted to perfect that first. And then once they do that, they're going to go on to possibly using their sensors and the Arduino program they come up with for certain environments. So I long term, they want to be able to manage white rooms. Anybody know what a white room is?
White room. I know what a clean room is. I can guess.
Yeah, it's pretty much the same thing, right? So in manufacturing or testing or labs or whatever, you have to have a certain level of cleanliness and you know, things have to be controlled to a high level. And so they want to get that good with IoT and Arduinos and sensors that they could possibly come up with a product or a program that they can sell to folks. So, and it's funny, on that team we have a PhD student, right? And he's awesome. But our best coder on our team is a 14-year-old kid. So it's across the board, it's all ages, and that's what we're trying to push. We're trying to encourage that. So I'm telling you guys that because it's DNewTech. We also have programs such as not just Blackstone LaunchPad and Hack WSU. We also have the Warrior Fund, which is a competition that is limited to Wayne State affiliates. That means people that are students, staff, faculty, or alum that could pitch for funding. And so that goes on once a year, and you can win up to $5,000 if you first come and start meeting with us through our LaunchPad program, and we invite you. Once we invite you, then you have to pitch in front of some internal entrepreneurial professors across the College of Engineering, Fine Performing Arts, as well as School of Business, of course. And then once you get past that gate, you pitch in front of investors like Invest Detroit and who are some other folks, Jason, we had there? Solid Ideas. Yeah. So the point is that you pitch, if you make it to the end, you could win $5,000 or up to $5,000, but then also the big thing is that you're interacting with these venture capitalists or angel investors or loan officers from Comerica. Comerica, actually, they're the sponsors of this year. So we want that to happen so that not necessarily that you get money. Money's always a good thing, right? I mean, those competitions that people win, money's a good thing. But the biggest thing you get is connections. right? We've got a couple of our winners already communicating with our judges. Our judges have always commit to being mentors. So it's not just, here's the money and go, good luck. We have people working with them, with the actual winners this year for, that were from the judging panel. Go ahead, sir.
Questions. Do relationships ever develop between runners-up and the mentors? Does that happen in the process of going through this?
You said, do relationships ever
develop between people who don't win or don't
yes.
win the big bucks,
yeah.
but yeah. develop relationships with
yes.
the mentor?
Yes. So that is also what we've done too. We had like 11 solid entries, and we only had about four or five. We had four people pitch in the final round, and three of them won funding. But the other 11 are actually being talked to and interfacing with some of our judges. That's correct. So yeah, so we have this village mentality, right? We want to help surround our participants with resources. You know, participants that work hard, you know, on their businesses, we want to get them the people that actually would like to see them succeed, and we want to get a lot of those folks around them. Yes?
Pardon me, sir, but looking around the room tonight,
yes.
I see a lot of men. I know for a fact, though, women are highly involved in technology.
So
sometime in the future, might we see at least one or two women, or in the past, do you remember women attending this?
Oh, DNewTech or our program?
Anything.
Oh, so yes. Yeah,
I'd like
so,
to see women so, because I know yeah. women are involved in technology.
So I'll say this.
I'll see you my number.
Thank you. That's an instant answer.
And the reason women are here is they're managing back to y'all.
So no, you know that's true. A lot of our teams that have women entrepreneurs in it. Typically, what we've seen is that just I'll be honest, the guys, you know, we have kind of this bravado and we say let's go ahead and go do this right without truly thinking it through. So a lot of our more successful teams are usually balanced and have women on the teams. So typically, women think things through a bit better.
Between the two of you, you answered my question fully.
So, in actuality, too, when it comes to numbers, I think we only have about high 20% of women in our programs. But when it comes to like our last two or three quarters, they've always been half of the companies that were women owned. Half the companies that were women owned. Actually, they're the ones that actually made money. Sorry, so 50% of our in the last couple quarters has been women businesses that were making money. So that should tell you something right there. But we definitely want everybody, and that's the point. We don't want anybody to feel like there's a barrier, period, to technology or entrepreneurship. You know, we have folks, again, that are like high school that come to our tech programs, our Hack WSU program, Hacker Nights, but we also have, you know, we have students and alumni that are senior citizens that are involved in our programs as well. Our whole goal is to bust down those doors that are in our own minds that we think that we are ceilings that we think we cannot get above, and is to provide the resources and tools and the people, the community, to help individuals take whatever they're trying to work on to the next level. So the word can't we hate, we destroy that word, can't. So the only time you use can't is when you say you can't use the word can't. That's it. All right. So we have had amazing individuals that come through our program that are doing well, and we've had many that have failed. I have one student that had two companies. One was a tech company. He was not a technologist. He was able to grab some people to help him code. They did coding for him. He even actually had he had a PhD student that was developing something that Wayne State owned, and he was going to use that technology. He was great. He was polished. He even actually had Ohio State as a potential customer, you know, for this technology. And he and his teammate kind of botched it. All right, they did not have everybody. They didn't have all the right tools or individuals with certain skill sets on their team to make it actually happen. And did that? Did he stop there? No. The guy, the young man, ran a campaign for a state legislator, and unfortunately, that person lost by like 30 votes. He didn't stop there. Well, he went on to run one of our other companies that was started in our office, a nonprofit. And he actually made that nonprofit just grow. The nonprofit was. What they used to do is they placed individuals that used to be in the juvenile detention program that were now adults. They helped them place them in internships and learn business etiquette. And they helped them move on from internships to potential jobs. And they had like 40% of the people that participated in this program would move on to a permanent position and where they interned, which is like super high and blows like Michigan Works numbers out the water. So the state of Michigan actually has adopted their structure. So this gentleman went on to put more structure behind it. They were able to actually raise more funding. They had 100 people involved in the program at one time. But that too, he had to say goodbye to that as well. But he ended up he's now running the entrepreneurship program out of Automation Alley. So Don Holmes, I don't know if you know Don Holmes or not, but he, in a span of 3 years, and from being a young man that was majoring in public affairs to being a part of two companies that were closed down, right? And a failed campaign to having an awesome job where he's a part of this ecosystem and helping others today. So that's in my mind, that's a failure, but that's a huge success. So we have little ladies that bake cakes, but also teach seniors in the community how to cook healthy that have limited resources. We have folks that have started tech companies, video game design companies. We have individuals that we helped out. Has anybody ever gone to Shop Talk at the social club? It's a barbershop. Well, anyways, it's a barbershop that's on campus, the salon, and they've taken TED Talks and put it in the barber's chair, and they've gone to every Shinola in the country, and the one in London, and they've had like local stars in the entrepreneurial system, give their talk on like a TED talk while they're getting a haircut. So it's pretty big, it's pretty fun. This young man is probably going to open up his next store soon. He's got notoriety. We've helped nonprofits start as well. As I mentioned earlier, we have a young lady that started a support group for girls and women who have inflammatory bowel disease, and that program actually is global now. They have thousands of members. She's able to quit her job, and she's running it with the staff. So we have everything you can think of. What are some of the things that you guys are working on? Really quick. I've talked too much. No, so you said go ahead. You were saying something?
I said I'm pitching, but Brian's Backyard Inc.
Backyard Inc.?
Yes.
Backyard Inc. What is that?
It's a sports amusement park.
Sports and amusement park?
Sports amusement park.
Okay.
So it's a C corporation. I'm registered in Michigan.
Okay.
And I don't know.
So yeah. So what was the what did you see the need there? What did you see that was lacking? Because usually it's like a pain or something that we see, right?
Right. So basically, it came from my childhood. I played a lot of basketball.
Yes.
And I realized that really kept me away from a lot of the dangers surrounding me.
Yes.
So Brian's Backyard was a haven for me. Brian's Backyard Inc. is a haven for the community.
Gotcha.
So really just to make a place where athletes and people that are interested in all types of sports can use their time and get through.
I'm not crushing the pitch on my pulling this information.
He's going to be presenting, so you'll be hearing from him soon.
Okay, okay. Do they have any more time? Or
yeah,
any...
I mean, you can ask questions if you want.
Yeah, so guys, please, if there's a question you may have about Wayne State, about our program, about Hacker Nights, again, that's a program we really are trying to have a community kind of own. Is there anything that I guess, I'll ask this question. If you had a magic wand, if you'd like to see a university do something for you with your business or your idea, what would you like to see? That's my question to you.
I'm curious about the Warrior Fund. Is that only for students?
Well, it's for students, staff, faculty, and alumni. So if you have been a student in the past, graduated, or maybe not graduated, you could be a part of that. Yes?
I came to Michigan in 1990 to work on the South Coast project out in Plymouth. I lived in Plymouth for about the next 10 years, moved into Detroit in 1999, the end of 1999. When I came to Michigan, again, what was that, 30 years ago, 35? I was concerned because Michigan was center of the automotive industry. I got here knowing that the local economy needed to diversify. It was such in 1990 that even if you didn't work in an auto plant, you still worked in automotive because everyone else around you did.
Yep.
I'm concerned that even if we diversify the economy and bring in a lot of technology, software, hardware, and you name it, if we're only catering to the automobile industry, we're in the same boat we've always been in.
Right. Well, I mean, I agree, but I think the narrative now is, in at least the last 5 years, is that, we're looking for diversity, right? We're looking for other industries to kind of sprout up here. And technology is a big part of that.
Types of industries that don't necessarily just flow into the auto.
Yeah, and it's not just technology too. Technology is awesome, and it's the least, it's the lowest barrier to entry. But also, example of Floyd. You guys heard of Floyd?
Yeah.
Yeah, Floyd is. I know that they used an old tool and die or a small manufacturing mom and pop shop to make their products, right? The legs for tables and countertops, or whatever. And so that's a good example of actually taking the automotive business, right? And it being a part of the new industry. So that, and I'm hoping to see that a lot more of that too. Go ahead, sir.
I'm very interested in trying to find some of the entrepreneurial college students that would like to work with startups. If I'd like, I can hire someone that is interested in a startup, but not necessarily experienced enough to start up their own. Where do I find those people?
So our office, you know, students are coming to our programs, they come to our events. That's, I would say from us, if you sign up with us, maybe you get on our mailing list, whatever, you can see some of our events going on. You can go to our website, innovationwarriors.wayne.edu, and just show up. You can also communicate with us. I mean, you can email us and say, hey, I'm looking for students for A, B, and C, and we'll do email blast at least once a month on opportunities. So we see that all the time. There's a lot of startups that actually want to hire students or sometimes have an internship for them, and we want to get the students to you guys. So just constant communication.
And I'll add to that because of my business, we actually hire a lot of interns and most of our college kids. And due to the fact that all universities now, as far as I know, has a program that has like a startup career fair, where they actually bring the startup companies out there and let the kids kind of learn what a startup mentality or startup environment might look like. So that way it would encourage them to kind of intern with someone who might not pay them as much as a GM or a Fortune 500. I think there's a price for that too. They do charge companies, small startup companies, a small fee to get involved in something like that. But there's also other opportunities out there, not only in the university, but in high schools now, that are getting companies out, which I'm a big part of in the Oakland County, to go out to the high school and see if you can actually get students to get involved into the startup community.
Right.
I think there's also a startup company that does, I'm talking about a recruitment.
Yeah.
For, they just pitched over the holiday, right? I can't remember the company, but there's a monster-like type of company, software company.
Was that in the Detroit Ventures portfolio?
Yeah. I can't remember the name of the company.
Yeah, I can't remember it as well. But yeah, just, I mean, we're down the street. There, you know, there's a ton of students there that are always looking for opportunities. And sometimes we've had in the past where people have been able to post their job opportunities like with the school of business, and they've gotten some good results. So Wednesday student, just FYI, is mostly non-traditional, right? It's not typically your 18 to 22 year old. It's a lot of times it's your 27-year-old who's going back to school, or your 67-year-old who's going back to school, right? So what you do get out of Wayne State a lot of is maturity, which is a very good thing if you want somebody to be responsible. So that's what I've seen our biggest commodity, our mature students that are possibly on their trying to change their careers or coming back to school, and they just have that maturity. So I mean, I love being there. Everybody's there, all cultures, all ages, whatever. And then we have 13 colleges, so it's different majors. A lot of our students that are good coders, aren't necessarily computer science students. But if you're looking for coders, and if you want to kind of help pick some of that talent or see that talent developing, our hacker nights are just a great thing to be a part of. And again, you can come working on your project as well. So it's open to anybody.
Yes. Can you post your contact information, website, and meetup so
you can
all get it?
Yeah. Yeah. I'll do that. I've got
it in the comment section.
Yeah. Okay.
Of this event.
We'll do that.
Is the question over there?
Yep, sir.
How much amount of code do you have?
Hacker Nights, you're going to have zero. So we've done it three different ways, okay? The first, in the summertime, was a lot of fun. We did Arduino projects that we found off the internet, and two students that were very, very, very talented, they're electrical engineering majors. They helped lead teams in building like 3D printer out of like 3 CD-ROMs and the heat pin. We took remote control cars throughout the circuitry and put in Arduino, and then we controlled it with a computer and then the phone. So those were mini projects we did in the summertime. Last semester it was free for all, whatever you want to work on. We had GE there to help you out. But this semester we're going to have Detroit Labs there, and so they will actually run somewhat of a class on your work on this project, and they'll be there to help you. So you don't have to have skills, but I mean, to stay plugged in, you got to put in the work. You got to be willing to jump in there, and that's what we want. We want people that we don't care about your skill level. We just want people that really want to get into it to be there, right? And we have something with a guy that enjoys just being around that environment, and they'll work on something else, and that's fine. They can stay there too. We have like graphic designers like working on projects, and that's fine. We're trying to be an open door to the ideas and the technology and those who desire to be a part of that community. It's an open door to you guys.
So pretty much roll up your sleeves, right? Roll up your sleeves.
Yeah, roll up your sleeves. Roll up your sleeves, and don't be shy, and talk to folks, and get to know them, and I'm telling you, some of those 14-year-old kids, they're probably the smartest kids there. You might want to grab them and be on your team. So, and one kid is 14, showed up with a video game he already built, and we're like, whoa.
And did they come from a salary kid?
Pardon me?
Did they come from a salary kid?
I don't know if they did. I don't know.
So, I appreciate Aubrey. Okay. Any questions out for Aubrey? He's going to stick around. He's going to listen to all the pitch. We're going to have him all for the rest of the night. All right?
Awesome. Okay.
And then make sure you put your information on the comment section.
I will. 1-800 for a good time. No, thanks, right. Guys.
We're going to start with Stu. You can come up here, Stu.
Speaking
What's that?
Speaking
yeah, we're going to go through a works on the list first. So,
that's annoying.
Do you have to be simple?
No.
You think you're last. No, they're second to last, aren't you? Yeah.
There you go. And just hit the space bar.
The space bar?
Yep.
All right, guys. Thanks a lot for having me. That was great information too, Aubrey. Thanks for that. I was going to do a presentation mostly just on my company, and I thought about, the group, and I thought you guys would benefit hearing first about a little bit about my entrepreneurial journey, which is, I'm 47 and it started at 10, so I'll do it fast, but I think it'll be good to lead up into my presentation. I've always been an entrepreneur. When I was 10 years old at camp, I would go to camp, I'd bring comic books, and I would always read all my comic books, and I realized that all the kids had comic books, so I started trading with the kids, and I started buying and selling comic books, and bringing home tons of comic books and money when I was 10 years old. So, I mean, that was the start of my entrepreneurial journey. I then, in college, I was a sophomore and went to University of Illinois. Big Greek system. I was in a fraternity. Am I in the way? All right.
Well, you're blocking the screen.
Okay, I'm not going to be on that for a little bit, but that's fine. So in college, I was in a fraternity, and we had a terrible pop machine, and we had a house of like 100 people in it, and I noticed all the other fraternities and sororities on the campus also had bad pop machines. So I found a local vendor at the time to work with me, and we placed pop machines and candy machines all around the campuses, and we had about 90 machines placed. I got a piece for everything sold, and had a couple kids in the fraternities work for me to help sell the machines. So that was a business I did as a sophomore in college. So just very entrepreneurial. I majored in accounting, hated it, worked at Ernst & Young for 2 years after college because I had to do something, I guess with my major, at least my mom led me to that, and I just hated it. So I quit cold turkey knowing I'm an entrepreneur, I will find something, and that's what I am. So not that long after that, had nothing going on, I ran into a friend walking my dog in my, I mean, living in Chicago at the time, knew him from like high school, a little bit older than me, said, why don't you come check out what I do? He was a used machinery dealer. And I went and checked out his business. He bought and sold used machinery. I never knew anything about used machinery. The machine tool industry is a huge industry worldwide. And worked with him for a couple months. And then my brother called me and said, Stu, he said, we got an opportunity to do a ice cream business, sell ice cream in ice cream carts down at the beach in Chicago. Are you interested in running this business for us? And for me, always wanting to do my own things, I decided, yeah, I'm going to take this opportunity. Left my friend after 3 months and went and started this ice cream cart business. And we did, I don't know if you guys know Chicago that well, there's a really big beach business down there. We were at Shedd Aquarium, North Avenue Beach, Oak Street Beach, and doing great. Then the summer's over, it's only a 4 month season. Winter came along. I love this machine tool industry that I got introduced to, so I had an idea to start a fax advertising business. This is only in the mid 90s here, so internet was not big then. So my idea was to, I accumulated a big fax database of end users and people in the industry, and I would go out to auctioneers and I'd say, hey, for 25 cents, I'll send you a fax, and you pick an area of the country for your auction, and we'd send out a blast of auction notices, 25 cents each. We paid like 10 cents each, that was our margin. So that was my business, nice little business. Second year came of the beach business, we took over some more properties or locations, we started selling pretzels. So the first year of the beach business, we did about 300 grand. So I want to show you guys the growth, this is back when I was in my mid-20s. Second year, we did almost 600 grand. This is in a short period. But then, that was going well. I had my fax advertising business, my beach business, and then after 3 years, a couple things happened, and this is when fate changed. First off, the city of Chicago decided they're not going to do ice cream carts anymore on the beach, or at least that was probably going to happen, so we're unlikely to get our contract renewed. And then the worst thing of all, and I choke up when I tell the story, but we had a fire. So I lost my entire fax advertising business and all my concessions was burned in a fire. And fire was not our fault. We did have some stuff insured, but definitely not enough. And so that was a very devastating moment. A month before that happened, though, I had written down on a piece of paper an idea I had for machinetools.com. So, and I'm going to talk about that. I have a couple more minutes left, but I'm going to talk about that now. But just want to give up the path that. But when the fire started, I'll never forget this. The girl running the fax business, her name is Julie. I looked at her. I said, Julie, this is a sign for us to start machinetools.com. This is now in like, and also January 20th was a date because Michael Jordan, I was a huge fan of Michael Jordan. He retired officially. He retired like three times, but on this date, January 20th, 1999, that's when I started machinetools.com. So the company, you have a little thing here so showing, we it's a really easy concept we do. Why I'm here is, I enjoy, sharing the success of my company I built over 17 years. Now we're 17 years ahead. I gave you up till basically 1999 when I started it. I'm also looking for new ideas to help us grow. I'm a little different than most people. I'm not really here pitching for money or, necessarily, always looking for good people, of course. What do we do? We connect buyers and sellers of new and used machinery across the world. Very easy concept. Since 1999 has not really changed. That's what we do. How do we do it? We have a very functional website. That's really the bottom line. Our site allows people in the industry to find machines by the type, by their brand. Then when they get to the type, they can filter by specifications. There's a lot of industry searching and functionality that makes the site really work. We have a great mobile version. The history, is that my time already? Okay, another minute, we'll be done. All right. We start with fax transmissions. I already talked about that. Then I started the company in 1999. 2007, we launched our first mobile app, which has now been 10 years, but that was ahead of its time, and we expanded new machinery. Just quickly, our stats, we have over 300,000 registered users. We're very global, 190 countries use our site. We have 2 million visitors a year. We have over 300,000 listings on our site. Over 2 million leads have been sent. We're not an e-commerce site, we're a lead generation site, because these are expensive machines. You're not buying a machine with your credit card. We're generating leads for buyers, excuse me, for sellers from the buyers. We have offices around the country. Not, it also expands because we want to have customer service and sales in bigger countries. This is not at all because we want to have cheaper labor. This is actually because we need these people in these countries. Last thing, are how we make money. Used machines, we charge a listing fee. New machines, we charge per lead. We have banner ads. But about 75% of our revenue comes from the first two things, which is really the new and used machines. We have auction listings, which are not like eBay auctions. These are like auctions like a General Motors plant goes out of business and an auctioneer lists on our site. We have wantages, and we do email blast rental. And there's we're always marketing. We're at trade shows. We give away pies, Michigan cherry pies. We do a lot of advertising. Our culture of our company is very unique. Our average person has been here 8 years. We have 18 employees, so I'm very proud of that. 8+ years is my most proud thing of my company. We have unlimited vacation. We have flexible hours. Most of my employees work from home. We use a tool called Slack, which a lot of people already know about. It's incredible. Anyone who doesn't use Slack for the company is missing out. It's very, very smart to use Slack for collaboration. It's a good water cooler. You know, for us, we're virtual, so it's important. And I'm very accessible. I mean, I talk to every one of my employees. I work for my employees. That's what I do. I really am very accessible to them. And the last thing is a couple things going on this year. We have a redesign of our website. You know, just some other things we're going. I don't want to take too much time. Sorry, Tim, but that was it. So, yeah. So I rushed at the end there, but I didn't want to like take someone else's time. So, yeah. Anyone? Go ahead.
Yeah. So yeah. When you first started this MachineTools, how did you get your first customers?
It's a great question. So I actually did a free. I let every dealer, and by the way, too, like most of the people listing on our site are dealers, meaning they buy and sell versus end users. We let either list. End user being like General Motors. Usually General Motors goes to a dealer and then the dealer lists on our site. We went out to all the dealers. We said list for free on our site, and we're gonna let you list for like a year. And we did for a year, and they're like the internet selling machines. They after a year got so many leads. Then we started charging. Like half of them stopped. They all eventually came back though, but that's how we did it. We did it for free, which is risky, but that's what we did. Yeah.
All right, so I have a question. So let's say I have a startup and I need equipment. I buy equipment from you, but then like, how do you get me to refer you to somebody else or to get me to become a repeat buyer?
Well, I guess I wrestle a bit because we don't sell anything. So we're the marketplace. So buyers and sellers are listing. So how do you get back to our site? Is that what you're asking?
How do you get like repeat traffic
to our site? Okay, well, so for instance, we have a critical mass now of buyers and sellers. So now people that are buying or selling, if you're going to sell a machine tool, our site is pretty much known in the world to be a very good option to sell. So we've over 7 years, people know us now. But we use Google AdWords, we use Facebook ads, we do a lot of marketing. But we have 300,000 listings, so that's probably the biggest reason people use us because we have the most content.
Just wondering, what's like the average cost of a machine that's sold on your?
Oh, well, so new machines are about 100,000, used about 25,000. So that's the average.
Okay. Competition. I don't remember if you guys or somebody else back in the day. Is there competition locally that sells and helps, you know, bring buyers and sellers together? And if there is, do they have a different revenue level?
Well, to be honest, when we started the company in 99, which I started, I had one main angel investor. I said, this is a model we're going to be doing. And everyone else had a different model, and they're all gone. And there was a couple from Michigan. There's a couple of competitors. There's a big company in Germany, and there's a company in Chicago that's a classified used service. But there's in eBay's kind of now in the business space. But the difference is we are transparent. We don't take commissions. Actually, I forgot to say it in the presentation. That's a huge thing about our business. We don't take any commissions. You know, so we don't have to hide the seller's name.
That's our model I heard back in the day was they took permission.
But you can't do that because people, like, you gotta, like, these are $50,000 machines. I'm not gonna buy it without seeing the seller. I gotta go see it, inspect it, and talk to the guy. So we don't take any commissions. People love that about our site. So we make our money $15 at a time. Yep.
Hi,
Have you heard of either QAD, also known as MFG Pro?
MFG quote? I mean, that's tooling and accessories stuff?
No, MFG Pro is for repetitive manufacturing software.
MFG
that's
quote?
That's the application. It's written in progress.
Okay. Not really familiar.
Thank you.
Sorry.
So you came with an ask of wanting to know or wanting to have other ideas for is it for revenue for this company or just
It was that. I mean, I can't expect someone like in 5 minutes here in my business to be like, hey, here's a great idea to grow your business. But if someone has something afterwards, I love to have ideas from anybody. Absolutely. For this business. This is what I focus on now. This is it. I mean, you know, I had a couple years where I took my eye off of this and did some other startups. And I realized, like, this is where our focus should be.
Let me ask you something. So because you're connecting buyers and sellers, the sellers are the ones that obviously make the most money because they're selling actually.
They pay me, yeah. They pay me. The buyers don't. Yeah.
Is there an opportunity for you to be like a Costco in the sense where you have your own brand of machinery that you either buy and then turn on itself, or you have the delivery system?
Yeah, like a generic brand, kind of like they do.
Yeah.
The reason we can't do that, and I will never do that, is because we are the marketplace. And even though Amazon gets away with it, I don't know how they do it because I don't want to compete against my customers. So if we were also buying and selling, they would think that we, because I could see every lead that comes in every day. We get 1,000 leads a day. I could see every lead that everyone gets. And if we shared that or if I had access to that and I was selling, buying myself, people would not like that. So we have to be objective all the way. That's how I've done it. So. But it's a good idea, actually. We could sell a lot of machines. Yeah.
Why not move to cash for the company?
Move to cash?
Yeah, why not handle the transaction?
Well, because I was saying, like, these transactions are done off of the site. So as soon as they're off of the site, you're going to trust these people to pay you commissions? I mean, they're going to, I'm flying to Florida to see this $100,000 machine. I have to rely on them to tell me if it was done. I mean, it's just, I chose from the start to not have anything to do with it. Plus, we have no liability. We get involved in nothing about the machines. We're a classified system, so that helps a lot. I mean, eBay has problems, trust me. eBay has problems going around, people going around them and liabilities and all that. We don't have any of that. So.
Any other, one more question?
All right,
thanks, Stu.
Thanks so much.
All right, so what we're gonna have next up is... Is Daniel?
Yeah.
You got yours, man?
Yeah, I just gotta sign in. Or...
All right. Okay.
I can use my computer or use this. Doesn't matter.
Just go ahead and sign in. All
right. Just go sign in your Gmail.
Oh, you sign in your Gmail?
Yeah. Yeah. I can use mine though. Just plug mine in.
Yeah. Go ahead.
All right.
Yeah,
I'm straight. I think?
Oh, you don't?
Yeah. I do.
You got it?
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, now where should I stand?
All right.
So behind the thing?
Okay, we're going to use Daniel. To this one, Daniel. You got 5 minutes.
I can tell. All right, here it goes. Hi, I'm Dan. I'm from Canna Jobs. We're the Indeed for weed. So we're based out of Michigan. We're a resource for our cannabis industry, job seekers, and employers alike. The problem is, so cannabis job boards look like crap. They look like a stoner made them. No web design. I mean, just they look pretty bad. Existing job board companies rarely work directly with businesses. We're looking to build relationships with these companies. I mean, you know, VCs and large investors are already investing in cannabis out west. California has, I mean, Microsoft just did investment. It's getting ridiculous. So Michigan's on track to be the third largest state for cannabis. So that's kind of like where we're heading to. This is just accentuation of the problems. Websites don't offer enough resources, and employers have no way of knowing if the employee has like a criminal background or anything. So we're going to offer like a verified listing. Here's our solution. This is Canna Jobs, mycannajobs.com. You can pull it up on a mobile browser. Looks the same. So yeah, so this is what's different about us and like what we intend to do as an industry whole. We have a very nice web design. It's very functional, user friendly. Most of our jobs are verified, where we get them from verified sources. We want to, like I said, build relationships with, like, you know, the businesses and employers. That's the main stuff. So here's the Michigan market. We have 204,000 registered patients in Michigan. Michigan's population is 9.9 million, which is double Colorado. So Michigan and Cranes, Detroit did a write-up recently. They think that we're going to do like 711 million just in tax revenue for the state. Yeah, so cannabis is already faster than the dot-com boom as an industry. So it's moving pretty quick. Here's our subscription model. So employers right now are signing up for free, but in the future it'll be $9.99 for 30 days. So a subscription monthly account. Where right now they can pay $99 for the year to list with us. Verified candidates, we're still working on getting that up, but what that will be is kind of, when you go and submit your resume, you'll be able to choose your package. If you go verified candidate, we do a background check, and we're gonna implement maybe working with like the state of Colorado with their badge system, because in the state you have to get a badge in order to work in the industry. So we're gonna try and integrate that into our website and into our business model. So this is the future. We're gonna obviously be an app. Right now we're just kind of a website. We're already working on knocking out the app and the design. So that's that. Any questions?
Yeah.
What are you asking?
Yeah.
Right now we're looking for 20K.
To do what?
Advertising, mobile, marketing basically in a whole. I mean, we're already getting site traffic. My bounce rate is like 45%, which is ridiculously low. We're a new site, we've only been up for 8 days, and we've already exceeded over 1,500 page views with no advertising.
What's your team look like right now?
Me, and I have a co-founder.
Okay.
She's a master marketer.
Are you doing the development yourself?
It's MVP design, yes.
So you said advertising. Understand this would be that your customer is the business owner.
Right.
So it's advertising trying to find them.
So we want to market to the business owners. So yeah, we're going to hire like a commission-based sales team to go and kind of get that started. We also want to travel to like the trade shows in cannabis and, you know, market that way as well. But yeah, we definitely want to kind of build relationships with employers rather than, you know, the consumers themselves, the job seekers.
So what is your strategy to get them? Because I'm imagining this industry, it's not necessarily they're looking for job boards online to hire people.
Yeah, they don't. So that's another thing. Is like I said, in person is very strategic. Yes.
One of your web pages said that jobs are verified. Do they get weeded out from time to time? I see a lot of things on the internet that might be there for 6-8 years.
Right, so we're going to have a verified badge. So what will happen is on each of the user's profile, or the candidates as we call them, they'll have a badge that says they're verified by us.
No, but the jobs.
Oh, the jobs are verified. Yeah, when we pull jobs, they're not just going to be like some crazy listing from middle of nowhere.
Or are they examined from time to time, let's say every 6 or 8 months?
Yeah, so our listings automatically will have application deadlines, and they'll just die by themselves.
Are you looking specifically in Michigan or kind of across the country?
Right now, we're based out here in Michigan, and Michigan's market is changing as a new law just came into effect on the 20th. Mm-hmm. So I'm a Michigan boy, so we're launching in Michigan first. But we do have listings in everywhere else right now. Yeah, we have listings all over.
Did you show what the size of the market? I know you said you showed dollars, right?
Right.
Like, how many jobs are out there potentially?
Right now, there's a lot with the industry growing.
Okay, do you have an idea what that is?
Cap size, no. but...
That's your business model.
Right.
So I'm being dispensaries, and what else?
Dispensaries, extraction, trimming is a job, growing. There's thousands of jobs. Everybody that does the lighting, anybody, you know.
Can we grow here now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Where?
Everywhere. The new licenses are coming out soon in December of next year. You can apply for a commercial license, but even before you apply, you have to have your team assembled. So you're going to have a full team of employees even before you send in the license paperwork. And so that's why we're trying to facilitate that for people.
Can that be grown in a large, like, you know?
Like 500 plants is the smallest grow license type.
Have you explored any of the cannabis industry accelerators?
I work with some people out west. I actually own the largest delivery service in St. Clair County, and a pretty decent. I do a connoisseur genetic grow, so we do all connoisseur grade above 20% plants.
May I attempt to answer the gentleman's question with one more type of business that would be cannabis?
Sure.
And that would be drug testing, quality assurance.
Right. Yeah. Even testing. I mean, everything. We're going to have every kind of, you know, companies that pop up just because of the plant, you know. So.
Some of the topics of afterwards, do they have filtering?
Yeah, you can filter. Right, you can filter.
Like this?
On Indeed, you can go on and type in marijuana or whatever, yes. but some of those jobs are just people that they need trimmers or you go, you know.
This is nothing like a substantial
No, not a niche market. So, any other questions? We're good? Sweet.
You beat the time both times, man. There you go. Thanks, Dan.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, we're going to bring in Alex and Alex. You want to use your laptop? They're from Cycle. They're based out in Toronto, but I'm hearing that they'll be relocated. I'm sorry, not Toronto, Toledo. My fault. I know, you guys just moved from Toledo to Toronto now to...
So much movement.
I know.
Is there enough room here?
Yeah, you can just put some light.
Okay. Over here?
Okay, we're good? All right. Hello, we're from Cycle. I'm Alex Mattoni, I'm the CTO. This is Alex Johnson, our lead developer. And this is gonna be less of a pitch and more of a presentation and a demo of what we've been working on. A lot of you probably don't know us, but we were over at DNewTech. We presented there a couple times. Love those guys, it's a good time. So you're probably asking, what is Cycle? Cycle is a fantastic way for you guys to get your applications, your programs, whatever it is you're working on and developing, online. A lot of people have been switching to a new technology called containers, which are kind of the next step in virtual machines. So if you guys are into industry hosting and doing all kinds of stuff where you actually need to finish your app and then get it somewhere, get it online, this is what we do. In the last year, we've been incredibly busy. Since we pitched over at DNewTech, we finished up automated SSL and TLS certificates, so it's a one-click installation for you to have HTTPS on your website. We've rebuilt our portal, we've got geographic redundancy, self-repair, you can manage your entire DNS right from our portal. And we've done a bunch of events. We've sponsored MHACs here over at the Masonic Temple. That was that's actually the biggest hackathon in the country, or in this part of the country, I believe.
In the world?
Yeah. Okay, yeah, in the world. That was a great time. We did a local one down in Toledo, Glass Hacks, with high schoolers who were getting into technology. And then we did Cal Hacks over at UC Berkeley. Our next steps, we actually released our API last month, so you guys can tie your applications into our platform directly to launch your applications. We've got some clients done for that. And then what we're going to be presenting today is our GeoDNS and scaling technologies that we built into the platform that allows you to one-click deploy into multiple data centers all over the world in seconds. So Johnson's going to talk about that, and I'm going to pull up our demo real quick.
Yeah, if you're not familiar with GeoDNS, GeoDNS lets you do two different things. It lets you have redundancy by having your applications in multiple data centers in case your applications go down. And also, it lowers your latency by having your applications in multiple data centers all over the world.
Environments.
Yep, and to prepare for the demo, the only thing we did was import an image, and he's going to open up an environment. Environments are a group of containers.
Oops, that's not it. That's bad.
That's okay. Me.
Yep.
And he's going to go and create a container. And we're going to name it whatever.
GeoDNS
test. And we're going to give it a domain.
I have a super edgy domain, interstellar.space. So, yeah, doing our demos there.
And we're going to pick the image that we imported beforehand.
A lot smaller than a virtual machine. If you guys haven't used container technologies, it's incredible what you can do with these things.
And we're going to give it a plan. The 128 megabyte plan will do for our needs. And we're going to select GeoDNS because that's what we're demoing right now, and multiple data centers, and three instances per data center.
Oh.
And we're going to go into the instances tab.
Yeah.
And then start. And we see that 9 instances are going to start up in total.
So that's the entire application already packaged up and ready to go in this format. You've called Linux container. It's like virtualization, but these run directly on the host. So you have very little difference between running that natively on a large server and running it through our containers. So we have that up now. I'm going to go over to the domain. And you can see since we're in Detroit, closest one to us is in Chicago. And then I'm also going to jump over to London. Let that connect really quick, and then we'll refresh. Refresh. Takes a second because we're going around the world now. Oh, actually, I should probably get off my other VPN.
Huh.
Too many VPNs. Reconnect.
Do you have a web application running in a container?
Yeah, yep. And it's geographically sensitive. Cycle makes certain environment variables accessible. As you can see, it's now location aware. So it says, oh, hey, you're coming from London, you're in Amsterdam now. Or if we want to go somewhere else, we can go to the West Coast. Let's go to Seattle. And it should connect to the instance over in Seattle,
or
in Phoenix, yeah. So then you can see that we're over in Phoenix. So with the click of a button, we just deployed a whole bunch of instances all around the world of our application running, which will automatically scale up to minimum and maximum instance sizes based on load. So that's our latest feature. That's what we do.
Where's the hardware that you're running on?
These are running on large servers in data centers from single hop. Which is our CEO, who's not here today. He was that was his previous place of employment. So we have a working relationship with SingleHop, but as we grow, eventually we're going to buy the servers directly and then place them into data centers and manage them ourselves.
SingleHop has data centers?
They work with data center companies and then they put their servers into there. So
kind of walk through the process. So I can do a Docker image, mm-hmm. and I import it in Cycle. Do all the wrapping of that for me, or do I have to do something in order to make my application be able to geo DNS aware?
So that depends on what you're building exactly. With Cycle, you give us the container and we just run it. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter if it's a server, if it's a game. It doesn't matter if it's a website. Whatever it is, if it's running on your local machine, we'll be able to run it. Through environment variables, we make it so that it can tap into where its location is from the platform, but that's kind of like an extra on top that Cycle does. But other than that, we just run the containers and give them IP addresses and manage it from there.
Very cool. maybe I'm like a little bit further back than everybody else. What price points are we talking about?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Price points, like money, like?
So we do, with infrastructure, it always gets a little bit complicated with how pricing works. And one of our big goals was to simplify the entire process of hosting, especially since this is a new technology. A lot of people are just starting to get into it. For the pricing, we decided to go with kind of two ideas. The first one being a tier-based model. I'll actually pull it up here too so you can see. Which is going to determine what feature set you want, and it's also going to determine your resources, your limits.
for bandwidth and storage, et cetera. And then per container instance, you pay a plan for the price. Our lowest plan is $2.50 a month, $2.50. And that's gonna get you 128 megabytes of RAM, 100 megabit public internet, 125 megabit private. And if you're traditionally running virtual machines, you might think 128 megabytes of RAM, well, that's nothing, I can't do anything. But when you think about containers in the context of they're just a process running on the host machine, 128 megabytes of RAM suddenly seems like a wide open field of space to play in. It's a lot for a single process to be able to run. So you could definitely run a small to medium sized website even with our smallest plan.
So are you competing with like Heroku and Amazon Web Services? That's your main
competition? In a way, yeah. They have their own container ideas that they're doing, but a lot of the competitors that are worth, probably our biggest one is gonna be
AWS,
Kubernetes is probably different, but the same idea.
Yeah, you have to install Kubernetes on your own servers and infrastructure, but we manage all the infrastructure.
Yeah, and then a lot of people who do allow you to install or to run it on their platform, they run the containers on top of virtual machines, and you're charged like it's a virtual machine, which isn't really taking advantage of what the containers are capable of.
How do you deal with cybersecurity? Personally, like,
so there's you know, definitely certain things that we can do to mitigate like DDoS attacks and stuff, and we have all of our networking is encrypted. So regardless of like your geographic location, if you have your container over in Amsterdam talking to your container in Phoenix, all of that traffic's gonna be encrypted. We also make it so that you can kind of take some of that into your own hands via whitelisting, so you can actually block people from accessing it from outside. You can actually disable the entire internet access to a certain container. So let's say you want to run a database application. You have your database in one container, your front end in another, and they connect. But you, since you have that private network via the environment, you can actually disable the entire public internet to your database, which means it's just not on the public internet whatsoever. But all of your containers within that environment are still able to communicate over their private networking.
How do you protect you guys, not necessarily the customers that you're set up?
What do you
mean? So you guys are setting up these containers or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
What if somebody just wants to create something that looks like it's going to be used by folks everywhere, and it's actually something that's just kind of
like a lookalike competitor?
Worm into your systems or whatever.
Worm into our system. I'm not sure how you.
We have SSL.
We have a certificate. Yeah, I mean, it's all HTTPS, so yeah. It's not like somebody can just spoof as a different website or something and pretend to be us on the web. But. Okay. Yeah.
So, what if you have a large database in San Francisco, geo-context sensitive versus Detroit database versus can you segregate out the database level? Granted, I know the storage might be, the same or older, but have different databases being connected.
That's going to actually be up to the developer and their database technologies. Like I said, once we get the containers, we're just running them. We don't really care about what's inside of it or how it's doing that. If it were me, what we do is, right now we work a lot with MongoDB, and you can do sharding and you can do master-slave setups like that, where you can have the rest of them reading from a master central database. I mean, with a database that kind of, you have to have one copy of the main data, because otherwise you're going to get split brain, you're not going to know what data is the accurate data. So
will this be more specific to locale? It's not actually data that's
You can set up multiple environments that you would, or it's really up to the developer how they want to organize that.
Would you have one more question?
How many customers do you have today?
Right now, we've got about 700 accounts that we launched back in September. I didn't mention that in the beginning. We just launched back in September. So far, we've gotten 700 accounts signed up, and we've got, I think, four or 500 active containers, or containers that have been created, and is it 400? So 400 containers have been created and running. Right now, we're starting to ramp up our marketing process at this point. So, I mean, we're working on that. It could be it could be better, but we're working on getting users right now. So we're integrating a marketing plan where we're working on a community section. Since when you're working with containers, a lot of the time people have to build the things first before they go to deploy them. So there's a little bit of ramp up time. Once we get the users on board, they may not have something that they need to deploy immediately. So we've been in contact with a lot of developers who are asking for tutorials. They're asking for resources on learning more about containers, because not just with Cycle, but with anybody doing container stuff, there's not a single like source of knowledge like you have with DigitalOcean when you're trying to figure out how to deploy a LAMP stack. If you search that, you're going to hit DigitalOcean's website. So what we're working on right now is a way for us to build that community, to build that kind of knowledge base and tutorials for people to learn how to use containers first, and then ramp up that with the marketing so that we can help our users deploy onto our platform. Thank you.
Good job, guys.
There was one more question, but we don't.
I can catch you up.
All right, yeah, sure.
Hey, good job, guys.
Thank you. You got it. We're going to be working on getting our Series A funding in June.
Awesome, man.
Yeah.
Hey, Brian, do you have slides or not? All right. So this one is going to be freestanding. So we're pretty much, this is Brian. We're going to introduce himself, and then we'll give you 5 minutes.
Have you ever done something you regret because you were bored? I have many times. That's why at the core of my business is a belief in knowledge that boredom is a strong contributor to lawlessness in the urban environment. Think about it. If people have nothing better to do, they end up destroying something, someone, or themselves. The questions I asked were, what can I do to help? And since I grew up in Detroit, how did I get through it? Answering those questions and pairing it with the entrepreneurial mind created my business and allowed me to do something amazing. Bridge the gap between my two passions of community service and entrepreneurship. I'm Brian Richardson, founder of Brian's Backyard Inc., the world's first sports amusement park. Imagine this, 10 acres of gated land. Inside the gate was also surrounding the park, a running and biking road. And then placed inside remarkable sports attractions. The best outdoor basketball court in America, a skate park, a 400 meter Olympic track, football field. There are 8 primary sports attractions, and we also have secondary attractions to meet the needs of the particular. Now, underneath this idea is the vehicle. We are an advertising company. By bringing in vast numbers of athletes, we can target companies that target those athletes to post advertisement in our park. And we have unique ways to make ourselves different from our competitors. What that allows us to do is grant-free entry to Detroit residents. So yes, amazingly, profits are not made directly on the backs of the Detroit community. That leads me to my favorite part, which is the impact. Brian's Backyard Inc. will decrease crime rates, raise property value, and create educational opportunities through sports. How? Like all parks, we're going to raise property value. But partnering with that, we seek to raise occupancy rates as well, which does an even better job at raising property value. Create educational opportunities. By partnering with secondary educational facilities, we can have them scout talent beyond basketball and football and really open people's eyes to Olympic sports and track and field and things they've never thought of. But most importantly, the main thing we want to do is decrease crime rates. We do this by, again, being free and open 15 hours a day. Then manage initiatives to bring in kids off the street. We are basically a vehicle that, by taking masses of people's time, eliminate boredom, and move them past hardship in their life. I like to say we're the vehicle the Motor City is missing. Thank you. Questions?
Awesome.
I'll start here.
So do you already have a park now, or are you trying to get that developed?
Yes, we have, and I know I'll get this question. We have proposed locations, and with that, our main buyer is the city of Detroit and the old recreation centers and abandoned schools. So to get going in that process, they want proof of funds. So phase one of our financial plan focuses on getting that proof of funds and securing the property. But we do have locations that we have identified that will work for us. Did you still have your question? I am.
So how much will it cost to like operate those things on your web, like to actually like make it, run it? I'm sure you're gonna have to have employees, you're gonna have to have parking. How much will all this cost?
Right. The total budget is vast, and it's started at $1 million. A little bit over $1 million. But with talking to, I have my business partner as a master's in business. That's why we have the phase system. All right, so now to get access to that capital, I've explained phase one, but then phase two is minimum to open, which we're just starting with, you know, just the bare bones. What do we need to get this off the ground and get some revenue and proof of concept? And then phase three on focuses on expansion. So that first phase is just $25,000. We'll get a lease similar to a DT got a lease that we want. It's $25,000 for 20-year lease. But then phase two, we're looking at $250,000 to minimum to open to start, you know, bringing in some revenue. And then I believe we're looking at, after we can prove the concept, being able to access a greater amount of funds to kind of expand more rapidly.
What about being started as a nonprofit? Have you thought about that?
We started as a nonprofit, but nonprofits can't sell like businesses can sell. So that idea was thoroughly investigated, and I decided to go outside the box. But actually, it's great because with our business, we make what's good for the business great for the community. I had a hand over here.
So actually, kind of touch on his idea. You actually could do both. You could actually have a nonprofit on the land, and therefore the business would pay the nonprofit to lease it from the nonprofit. That way, you could still have an aggressive revenue model, but still get donations for the business. I can tell you right now, for being in real estate, your number is, we're looking at a lot of schools, your number is low. Looking at what it's going to take to fix up a lot of these schools, especially with what you're talking about doing, $1 million is very low. You'll find that you'll go through construction very, very quickly when we have it. So I'm not saying this to be, just be giving realistic.
Right.
My point in saying that is you could have a two-tier system where it actually allows you to raise funds on a nonprofit side, so people can donate to it, get a tax write-off. That would help you get the funds to own the land and the building, which the nonprofit can own, and at least the space, because nonprofits can have a revenue, not that they can't have revenue.
Right.
And then your for-profit could actually be what goes out to the advertising companies, because if your model is not to charge people to come to this park, but the advertising would be, you're gonna need a massive amount before you can go to like a Nike or to whoever to advertise there. They're gonna wanna see that there's a good amount of people that not just 5 or 10 or 20 or 100 people coming. They're going to see thousands of people coming on a weekly, monthly basis. So you could actually do a two-tier system, which will help you get started faster.
You touched on a lot of things, and I'll have to talk to you after. But that we've identified actual schools, but we don't need as much space. A big part of the business model is to have a self-sufficient kind of system. Like, I don't need employees to run a basketball court, or but I do need a facility that's not as big as a school, nearly as big as a school, but to have managed entry, sell, you know, the Gatorades and sports equipment type of things, because we have other methods of generating revenue as well that are going to subsidize, because like you said, we got to ramp up the advertising, but we want to be able to sustain until that gets up there. There were hands everywhere. I have not talked to Pal, but if you know somebody,
yeah.
All right. Question in the back.
How do you make money again? I'm sorry, I missed that part. So how do, so what revenue streams do you plan to have? So like you said about selling some, sounds like some Gatorade and some refreshments and things of that nature. What other revenue streams do you have?
Right, like I said, the main one that we're going to move up is the advertisement, but also
advertise what?
Advertise businesses that target sports, health, and fitness demographics.
So physical advertising. So basically, inside these schools or facilities, there's going to be like a, let's say, an airport. Mm-hmm. I can walk through, and there's like classes of advertisements there selling the product. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's included. But we have a lot of different things that we can do that a lot of people can't do. I walked into, and I know I heard the bell. I walked into, what is it, Bed Bath & Beyond, and on Shark Tank they had the lady that did the little spin, the workout thing that you spin on. Okay. We can approach businesses like that where a lot of times people want to get on the thing and see if they like it. We can have these sorts of things where people can actually try products. And you can't go and try workout products in a lot of different places. So we have that. There's going to be a radio system that we're going to be able to say over the radio at 30-minute intervals, different type of things. So there's a lot of different things that we can do in the advertising market that isn't overcrowding the park with billboards. I have to check with him.
I have one more question, and then we'll turn it over to him.
You asked. Let me. I haven't seen you ask a lot of questions, and I could talk to you after.
How are you looking at to get the average consumer to come to the park? You know, that if you build it, they will come mentality, or what's your ideal goals to how to get the consumers there?
Right. So basically, we focus on, I got to talk about the competitors. The competitors are public parks, which aren't great in Detroit, so we're just gonna be better than them. And then other competitors are recreation centers. So recreation centers charge to get in per day, or they go by monthly memberships. So we hold an advantage over both. We're gonna be a great place, great safe place, so we're gonna be better than the parks. And then we're free to get into for the people that go to the recreation centers, but we also have great playing surfaces, great, you know, playing fields. So those who want to be a little bit more economically sound will choose us over them. So, but yes, there's marketing strategies too, and events and different things that will help just expose people to the park, and then we focus on turning them into repeat guests.
Yeah. Okay, so our last presenter tonight, Freya, can you come up and
good evening and Happy New Year to you all. My time to make technology a bit tastier and mouth-watering. My name is Priya Das and I'm co-founder of Nirmal for Disruptive Eating. And we are a mission first Indian food vendor operating a Nirmal cafe in Ypsilanti, Michigan since 2013. And our mission is to defeat obesity and overweight prevalence in Detroit, then Michigan, and then US, and then BN. Big goal. Then you would have a valid question, why disruptive eating? And what is disruptive eating? So I have so many whys to say. Why 70% of Americans are overweight? Why? After spending $100 billion every year for last 10 years, obesity rate inched up to 36% last year. Why obesity rate among African American women is 56%, Hispanic women 46%? Is the low income population disproportionately affected? And despite so many things you hear about obesity and overweight, 60% of US adult population does not know about body mass index. On top of that, last year global obesity report gave zero chance to stop the rise in obesity by 2025. We don't accept that. And we need not accept that. So how we do that? We need to disrupt the way we eat or drink. We have devised three ways. We start eating whole grain. 40% of US population does not eat whole grain at all. Second step, we don't need meat for protein. Plant proteins like lentils, tofu, soya chunks has equal protein with less fat and less cost. Third step, world is not turning into vegetarians overnight. So go for goat meat. It is healthier than chicken, you'd be surprised to know. And it is most sustainable. 1 pound of goat to get to self-stores takes only 127 gallons of water as compared to 1800 for beef and 700 for pork, most popular meat here. So how we do that? Like, it is not easy. Nobody is doing it. Indian food makes it easier, tastier, and healthy. Indian food is curry based, like you see here. So this is one kind of curry, tikka masala curry. So it is a liquid seasoning. So we eat with either parboiled rice or whole wheat bread. So once you start eating whole grain, automatically you are going to eat less meat. And this contains a lot of spices. Like Indian curry uses 200 spices out of 381 known so far. So if you eat tofu tikka masala or chicken tikka masala, your taste buds won't complain. They won't even notice. Proof is, India has 500 million vegetarians, 42% of its population. And credit goes to curry. But does it work for obesity? Obesity rate for Asians here in US is 12% as compared to 36% for all others. If you talk of Asians or Indians, we are also Asians. We have two similarities. We get 50% of calorie from whole grain, and we don't go to Planet Fitness or anywhere. So that is like kind of proof. Why Detroit? Because that is our battleground where we need like proof of concept for disruptivity. Detroit is fattest city with the highest poverty. If you think of 500,000 population out of 7,000 people living in food desert. We believe Detroit needs health equity first, which would be the key to fight income and educational inequality. Three components of social inequality if you talk about. What we have to do? We have to launch war on obesity. We don't have Army, Air Force, or Navy, but we do have three tools. First, the HPP package Indian curry. So this is HPP curry. So HPP is the high pressure pasteurizer. So here technology comes into this food. This is brand new technology. It keeps food fresh for 75 days without using any preservative. So how can we can take this curry to the masses? So what we are doing, we are taking it to Save-A-Lot, Dollar General, all these local grocery stores. This curry people can see and buy. Because Indian restaurants are few and far between. Indian food you can find in Meijer and Whole Foods, but they are in self-stable or they are in frozen. Both disturb the taste of spices. That is not working. Beauty of is that dinner for family of four, you can do in $9 instead of $15 for pizza dinner. What my family does once a month, so I know firsthand. Second tool is we need Nirmal Cafe for effective messaging. You interact once with our Nirmal in Ypsilanti, you would know what is BMI. And you would calculate it actually if you have never chance to do it. We are a space awardee for Motor City Match. We have applied for cash grant. We have signed LOI with Brightmoor Artisans Collective. So we are going to open Nirmal Cafe in Brightmoor. Third is tool is unique mobile app. I have a concept which would build an ecosystem for each right community. And this would be first app which would reward people for healthy eating. Yeah. We need from you 25,000 for urgent launching of this, and we need partners for Nirmal at Brightmoor, and we need someone to develop our concept for app and run it as a separate vendor. Questions? Thank you. Yeah, go ahead.
Does it taste good?
Oh, you have to try.
Yeah.
So this is one misconception, like people say Indian food is spicy. So spicy is not spicy hot. Always if anything is hot, it is made by chili, as in any other cuisine. Same thing we do. So it is mild. So when you taste the flavor of spicy, the spices, it is tasty. If you have not tried Indian food, you have to taste one.
Is this anywhere out in the market now?
What?
Your...
No, we have got orders from Sevelot and Patel Brother, and we have to fulfill that order. We are starting this month, we are launching this month, this package thing. Yeah.
So maybe the suggestion may be, was, so when I was a kid, right, so the real thing here is that you need to be able to overwhelm kids, because kids try to eat this, and I'm like, where's the chicken at? Have you thought about trying to get into schools first and try to introduce this food to kids when they're young, so as they get older, they'll get used to it?
I think we used to have contract with Aramark and Sodexo before. We used to go to UFM, Adrian College, EMU.
Yeah, but you're trying to go for urban market, right? So
yeah.
If you go for urban market, you need to go to the facilities and companies that provide the urban schools. So for instance, Canstrom is a huge company here that provide urban schools. So maybe you can talk to them and say, hey, maybe once a day, not once a day, but once a week, we have that Indian food day. And that way you can at least, because it sounds like you want to actually change the way people eat.
Yep.
And in order to do that, that needs to be something that happens over time. Yeah, it has to be acquired and all this good stuff. So maybe that's just an idea for you.
Yep.
Thank you. I know you're trying to move into the urban market, but are you in all of the Indian market right now first? I mean, it is an Indian food, right? Have you moved into the Indian market first? Because that seems like a market that will drive some revenue and then be able to do some other things.
So when you say Indian market, what do you mean by that?
The Indian type of supermarkets or restaurants or, you know, places that Indians frequent more often.
Yeah, so we have order from Patel Brothers. They are the biggest grocery chain in US. They have 300 stores in US. But one thing I would tell you honestly, we Indians cook at home mostly. Like if you ask about my family, we eat just once a week outside. So this is fresh, this is same like restaurant, but we don't eat much Indian food outside. So we prefer to home cook and eat. So, but still it is in grocery store for other people, not Indians. Yeah.
How much does it cost to make? How much do you sell for and how much does the store sell for?
So this is $3 for this 8 ounce and $5 for 16 ounce. And we have like margin of around 50%. Yeah.
I missed your answer to that question.
So cost, he was asking what is the cost and how much margin we have.
Yeah.
You mentioned a little bit about Indians directing at home. I agree with that when I'm at home, but I moved away from home. One of the hardest things for me is I'm really bad at cooking, and also being in Detroit, it's really hard for me to get Indian food that's close by.
That's
a lot of times I'll order Indian food and I'll taste it, like it's okay, but it's not my close taste.
So we are seeing very huge market for Indians who are alone, who does not cook, or the couple who are working, because this is as good as the restaurant. It does not have any preservative. So that is the first thing. What is happening? Look, when I was in school here, at Ross School of Business, I used to bring the same frozen food and it tasted so bad. So it was in my mind always, like if I can do something, if I get into this, how to find this? So HPP provide that. HPP was here like last 7-8 years, but we were not aware of it. So I have chance to meet Mr. Jack Aronson, or most of you may have heard, the Garden Fresh Salsa. He sold it to Campbell Soup last year. And he told, why you guys don't do HPP to curry? Like curry is something which is so tasty, but thing is that they are mixing, doing it frozen or self-stable, they are distorting the taste. So that is where my journey started.
Last question for Priya.
I got one last question for you. Nobody has answered. So who's your testers? Right? You went into urban markets, so who have you tested? Who's testing this product? That's the urban market. I'm assuming the average American primarily. So is urban Americans actually, you have set some test stuff, some people test this, do they like it? Have you done any of that?
Well, we have testing part, if you're asking. So we have different type of curry. So if you
ask, I'm asking an explicit question. When you did your testing party, was there black people there that you're trying to sell to that said, hey, I like this?
Oh yeah, not many. I'm a member of Detroit Food Lab.
Okay.
You may know the Devita Division.
No, those are foodies. I'm talking about regular African Americans that will be your end customer. Were they there?
I think we are in Ypsilanti. We get a lot of right, like so a figure making customers.
Thank you
for
answering my question. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks for yes. So usually at this last minute, we kind of go through any networks, any events that are going on. So does anyone know things that are going on? I know a couple of them is Ann Arbor New Tech. That's the first third Tuesday of every month. That's on the University of Michigan. And I believe there's a second coming January 27th. It's How to Start a Startup. And they're going to be at the new Bamboo, which is on Madison, in the Madison building. I don't know if you checked that out, but it's really literally around the corner here. That's a pretty cool place too. If you guys haven't seen that, that's a place for you to come and check out their next event, which is, I think it's January 27th, right? Any other events anyone
Ace.
Wants to mention? Ace War, yeah, that's...
And your collaboration for entrepreneurship.
Yep, and where's that gonna be at?
It's in Southfield the last Thursday of the month.
Southfield the last Thursday of the month.
Of so, January.
Does anyone, okay. So...
January 19th, there's a startup story night. It's
going to
be
an Amtrak,
but if you Google
it,
check on Facebook.
Okay, is that a meetup or is that a...
It should be a meetup, it's on Facebook, and I think it's also on Facebook.
Cool.
So,
also, Detroit Hacker Night starts on Mondays, January 1st.
And that was Hacker Night?
Yep.
And that's on what? Where is that at?
It'll be in the College of Engineering, and it has to be more from Drive and Warren.
Okay.
So
that'll be great. That'd be great. Yeah. If you guys have any of these events that you can share, just put it on the site because I think that gets the word out. And it's beer. We're gonna tonight. Roger, where are we going? Detroit Beer Company. So if you guys want to hang out, come out, hang out with us. It's literally around the corner. All right. Thanks, you guys. Happy New Year. It works. Hey, what's up?
Stuart, is that Stuart Carlin?
Yeah.